graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Saga of Recluce, Fall of Angels, Part 2 by L.E. Modesitt, Jr. Narrated by Ken Jackson and a full cast. Despite the heavy woolen blanket that covered the thin thermal blanket and the crude but heavy woolen nightshirt he wore, Neelan was cold. A thin layer of crystals from his own breath scattered off the blanket as he sat up. The room was dark, with only the hint of gray seeping through the thoroughly frosted single armor-glass window, although Neelan knew, alerted by the sounds drifting up the steps from the great room, that it was late enough. Another storm had descended upon the roof of the world, with yet more snow. A few fine flakes sifted around the iced-over shutters as Neelan sat on the edge of the couch and stared at the peg holding clothes he knew would feel like ice against his skin.
Don't take the covers. It's cold up here.
Another furnace day.
It's been a furnace day every day for the last 8 days, and we're running through wood all too fast. Fearl's coughing out her lungs because she's spent too much time in the cold. Istril's not that much better, and I worry because she's pregnant.
Arlen helped them both.
There's a limit to what she can do, though.
Reba sat up on the couch and swirled the covers around her.
I hate feeling this awkward.
You don't look awkward.
Neelan struggled into his clothes. He'd wash later. That bothered him, too, that even for him, cleanliness was falling behind the need to keep warm. He pulled on his boots.
Dileus is already affecting my balance. My bladder already went.
The Marshal of Westwind slipped to her feet.
I hate wearing this thing like a tent. At least I can still get into my leathers. Darkness knows how long that will last.
Reba pulled off the woolen gown. Her midsection was only slightly rounded, and the engineer wanted to shake his head. Reba would feel huge, while she was slimmer than most women who weren't even carrying a child.
I'm headed down.
Neelan had not even set foot on the stones of the main level when Kaisine greeted him.
Sir, the cistern's not filling. It's half full.
It'll wait.
Neelan walked to the table, looming out of the gloom like a rock out of the fog of a harbor. The insides of the shuttered window were masses of ice, created from drifted snow and the condensation from the guard's breath. The four true windows were so heavily frosted that they were solid white.
Amazing. The engineer arrived before the marshal.
What magic will you create, mage, to return the waters to the tower?
It's not magic, Gnarliot. It's a stone conduit that's probably frozen solid because I didn't get it buried far enough below the frost line.
Neelan snapped off a piece of bread and dipped it in a brown sauce that was left over from dinner the night before.
I haven't lived here before, and I had to guess.
But you are a mage.
You said that. I didn't.
Neelan took a bite. Both bread and sauce were cool. Even the tea was lukewarm. Across the table from Neelan, Arlen offered a faint smile of condolence, but said nothing as she sipped her own tea. The single fat candle on the table shed as much greasy smoke as light onto the last dried apple slices Neelan took from the wooden bowl.
I'll be getting a few more apples for the marshal, Sayre, and you can have a few, too.
Thank you.
He wondered why he should be thanking her, because the early birds had eaten everything. The fruit had not made its way up to the table by the time Reba sat down heavily in her chair with her back to the cold hearth.
You seem tired, Marshal.
Gnarly had smiled. From the middle of the second table, both Riesa and Mercasa looked at Reba, and then at Gerlick. Arlen frowned.
I am tired. I'm especially tired of your superficial cheerfulness, and I'm almost tempted to send you out hunting at this very moment, so don't push it.
I beg your pardon.
No, you don't. You just say you do. Snakes have more integrity than you do, Gerlick. So do the demons.
Neelan held in a grin. Beside Istril, at the far end of the second table, Relan paled.
You could even say, behind my back, that I'm in a bitchy mood. That's a mildly polite way of putting it. So the next time you attempt to patronize me, you might have to eat steel or ice. You can take your pick.
Kaisine hovered behind Neelan, holding the small bowl of dried fruit, waiting until Reba turned to the cook and nodded. Kaisine set the bowl between Reba and Neelan.
Thank you, Kaisine.
Thank you.
Thank you, thank you. It makes me puke.
Neelan glanced at Gerlich.
Why, Gerlich, I thought you had better digestion than that. By the way, the reason I'm usually late is that I have better things to do than to sneak around and complain about how things are run around here, or make snide remarks under my breath, or go out and hide and sulk in the snow while pretending to hunt.
Narlia turned pale. Gerlich opened his mouth and then shut it.
You know, Gerlich, you always did underestimate the engineer. In the end, it's likely to prove fatal.
Might I be excused?
Of course.
Gerlich stood and bowed, but not too deeply.
Your timing was excellent, Neelan. That should stop his plotting for a time.
A day or two, perhaps.
Are you going to kill him?
No. There's been enough death, and that sort of thing wouldn't play well with the guards. Not yet.
Neelan took several of the apple slices, but left most of them for Reba. She needed them, and so far he didn't. Arlen rose and nodded to the marshal, then to Neelan.
We'll be doing a lot of woodwork for the next few days, sir, and I need to see to the space and the glue.
Reba nodded, as did Neelan.
We have problems with the water, I understand.
I guess the frost line is lower than I'd calculated. But I'll have to check now that I've eaten and have some strength.
You made such a to-do about the water.
I know. It's all my fault.
All the guards in the kitchen area watched as he neared the cistern. Neelan opened the cover and peered inside. His eyes saw almost nothing, but his senses could feel that the inlet pipe was mostly filled with ice. The water level had dropped to the half-full point, a good 2 cubits below the stone inlet conduit. A few drops glistened on the ice-coated inlet spout. Neelan extended his senses, attempting to hold the feeling similar to the neuronet. So far as his senses could follow the water back up the conduit, he could sense only ice. Finally, he stepped away from the tower's cold south wall, leaving the cover open and turning to Kaisine, who had followed him down.
It's frozen. Keeping this open might help, but make sure everyone stays away from it.
Sir?
The air here is warmer. It might help thaw the ice inside. The piping wasn't deep enough. I'm pretty sure it's frozen outside as well.
What do we do? You can't fix it now, can you?
Kaisine made a vague gesture up the steps toward the heavy lower outer door, which continued to vibrate despite the southern exposure and the heavy windbreaks beyond.
We may not be able to fix it until spring, and that's a long time. For now, take the extra cauldrons and fill them with snow. Put them by the furnace. When they melt, pour the water into the cistern and start over. If we can get the water level up and warmer, it might help.
Should we put some on the stove?
Not until after meals are cooked. And don't add any wood to the fire. We really don't have enough wood as it is. The tower is warm enough down here to melt the snow.
Up in the room he and Reba shared, that was another story. The center space was warm enough, thanks to the furnace ducts, but only when the furnace was burning. The shuttered window had become a mass of immobile ice.
What about boiling water?
That won't do any good until the water levels up near the inlet spout. And that means melting a lot of water.
Now what are you gonna do?
I still have to check the bathhouse.
He crossed the kitchen and headed back up the steps to the north door.
That might tell me where the freezing's happening.
The north archway was cold, as usual, but the bathhouse was tolerable. Perhaps because Holdren had a fire going in the stove. Neelan climbed up the brick steps beside the wall, designed for just such a purpose, and checked the water warmer, which was 3/4 full. A thin stream of water trickled into the warmer's reservoir, but only a thin stream, even with the knife gate wide open.
How long have you had the fire going?
Not long, sir. Colder than a winter deer's rump in here earlier.
Maybe heating the stove will increase the flow more. If not, we can use the stove to melt snow, and perhaps the heat from that will also keep some water flowing. Once the storm lets up, I'll check the outfalls.
Hope the stove helps, sir.
So do I.
On the side of the lower level, away from the kitchen, opposite the furnace, Arlen directed a half dozen marines in their effort to turn rough wooden slabs and planks into furnishings for the tower. Wall partitions, stools, an occasional chair, and several cradles. Neelan stepped toward the group.
How is the water going, sir?
There's enough in the bathhouse for some washing, a few quick showers, and maybe more as the stove warms things up.
What about the cistern?
I can't do much about that now. We'll see if Cadran can get the water level up. That might help. If I can't fix the water, at least I can do something useful.
Neelan picked up the dovetailed section of the cradle that was beginning to resemble a headboard. Carving and fitting the pieces was slow, even with the glue Relan had developed from ground deer hooves and boiled hide and who knew what else. After studying the design he had scratched on the wood, Neelan set the headboard down and took out his knife, borrowing the common whetstone to sharpen it. Istril stepped up beside him, no longer nearly so slim in the midsection as she had been in the summer and early fall.
Can I follow the same pattern?
For the cradle, not the design.
Of course. Is there anything I can explain or help with?
Istril flushed. So did Neelan, although he didn't know why.
With the woodworking. I'm not an expert. That's Arlen.
That cradle looks very good, especially for the tools we have.
I've had a lot of time, and probably even more to come.
He's safer down here.
Both Sirrit and Istril turned toward the mouthy guard.
The Marshal. She is a little touchy. Right now.
Saren looked up from where she smoothed the curved back piece for what looked to be a chair.
You'd be touchy, too. She has to think of everything and put up with idiots like the Great Hunter.
Saren glanced toward the corner where Alicia quietly worked over another plain cradle.
I'm sorry, Alicia, I didn't...
No offense taken, Sare. He's a lying cur. I just hope he's got good genes.
Alicia showed broad, even teeth, then looked down over her swollen midsection at the sideboards she was painstakingly rounding. Neelan studied the design again, the sole tree twisting out of the rocky hillside, then let his senses take in the wood before he lifted the knife. Then he slowly drew the knife over the line that represented the right side of the rocky slope, deepening the groove gently, gently. Neelan blinked as a clot of snow, thrown up from Saren's skis and carried by a gust of wind, splattered above his left eye. Even though his determined efforts over the past 8 days to navigate and shoot a bow on skis remained an effort, he wasn't plunging headfirst into the snow or leaning backward until his skis slid out from under him. Saren held up a hand, and Neelan coasted to a stop right behind her, proud that he neither hit her nor fell into the deep snow beside the semi-trail that the guards had created through the lower forest. The snow around and across the roof of the world was more than 7 cubits deep and twice that in drifts. That was deep enough that Neelan could fall into one of those pits and never make his way out, not without cutting the thongs.
I think there are some deer and maybe a snow leopard downhill and to the right. The wind's coming uphill here, and I might be able to get close enough.
If I'm not stamping along?
She nodded.
Go on. We're always on the verge of running out of meat.
Can you just wait here, with your bow ready?
I'll wait with a bow handy. How much good it'll do, I'm not sure.
As the wind whispered through the evergreens, clumps of snow splattered around them, leaving pockmarks scattered on the once smooth white surface, depressions that the wind seemed to begin to fill immediately with feathery white powder that scudded along the snow. Another shadow darkened the roof of the world, and he looked up at the white cloud that scudded across the sun.
You'll do fine. Just don't let our supper get away.
Saren raised her left hand, and then slipped down the steeper section of the partly packed snow trail ahead. In moments, she was out of sight in the trees, gone as silently as if she had never been there. Neelan shrugged to unlimber the composite bow, wishing that he had practiced more with the weapon. The shadow of the cloud passed, and for a long time, nothing moved in the expanse of white beneath the overhanging firs, nothing except snow scudded between trunks by the light wind that rose and fell, rose and fell. A gray-winged form plunged from nowhere into a swirl of powdered snow, and a quick geyser of white erupted, then died away as the gray hawk flapped away a small white-coated rodent in its claws. As the hawk vanished, Neelan inched forward on the skis, mainly to shift his weight and keep his hips and knees from cramping in the cold. He looked back in the general direction of the tower, but could see nothing but snow, tree trunks, and the white-covered green of the fir branches. A rhythmic swishing, almost a series of whispering thuds, rose, just barely, over the hissing of the wind. Neelan squinted, looking downhill, when the snowcat bounded across the hillside toward the trail where he stood, moving so quickly that what had seemed a small figure swelled into a vision of knife claws and glinting teeth even as Neelan released his first arrow and reached for the second. triggering reflex step-up. The leopard reached the snow beside the flat section at the crest of the trail. The third arrow left the bowstring as the cat stretched toward kneeling. He managed to dive into the snow at the side of the trail. A line of fire slashed down his shoulder, his skis linked together, and he toppled into the deep snow, a heavy weight on his back. That weight did not move, and, in time, Neelan levered it away from him. Neelan finally struggled into the light. His knees ached, one leg burned, and the other threatened to cramp. Half sitting, half lying in the snow, he managed to reach one of the poles he had abandoned to use the bow, and with it, to retrieve the bow itself. He laid it on the edge of the harder snowpack of the trail. Then he looked at his boots and the mass of snow and ice around the thongs. He finally managed to totter erect. The claws had sliced through the heavy leather shoulder of the hunting jacket he had borrowed from Arlen, but blunted the impact enough that the wound was little more than a thin line skin deep. He looked at the snow-covered leopard, then downhill, but the forest was silent. After prodding the cat with one of his poles, Neelan knelt. He removed the first arrow shaft, wiping it clean on the snow, then replacing it in the quiver. Then he searched for the second. The sun was well past midday when Saren trudged uphill, pulling the carcass of a winter deer behind her. By then, Neelan had dragged the snow leopard out onto the trail and worked out the three arrows.
Sorry, Neelan, but we do need the meat, and it took me longer. What happened to you?
Saren stopped and stared at the bedraggled engineer, her eyes going from his shoulder to the body of the snow leopard.
It decided I'd make a good dinner. I tried not to oblige.
You were lucky.
Neelan nodded. His jaw still chattered and his knees were wobbly, especially as he looked at the stretched out length of the cat.
But they're all your shafts, so you get the fur. We all share the meat. That's a dubious benefit.
Snowcat meat was tough, gamey, and no pleasure for teeth or tongue, even in a well-cooked stew.
Meat you can split, but not the hide. What will you do with the fur? We all agreed that the choice is up to the one who brings the animal down, especially if you get wounded.
Neelan's eyes flicked to the slash in his jacket.
That's only a cut.
Her eyes looked to the depression beside the trail.
Your skis didn't move much.
That would have been futile.
So you stood there and fired three arrows at a charging leopard?
It does sound stupid when you put it that way.
Necessary. What would have happened if you'd tried to ski away?
I'd be under 10 cubits of snow or a midday meal for the leopard.
So, the pelt is yours. You earned it.
I suppose it'll make a good coverlet for Dileus. It's light and warmer than anything else.
Dileus? Reba's...
Neelan nodded.
Mine too.
That's a beautiful cradle you're making.
Thank you. It's almost done. And that's hard to believe. Don't we have to drag this beast somewhere?
You get to drag it home. I've got the deer. I even have some rope.
You are so obliging.
Think nothing of it.
How Neelan got the cat carcass back to the tower, he didn't know, only that his legs ached even more, his shoulder burned, as did his eyes, despite the eye black under and around them, which he'd have to wash off sooner or later. He felt lightheaded. He had taken off his skis and leaned against the causeway wall and watched as Cadrin and Saren set up the tripod and skinned and gutted the deer, and then the leopard. With the pelt off, the cat's carcass was thin, and Neelan felt almost sorry for the dead animal, even though it had certainly tried to kill it. A taller figure skied to a halt beyond the causeway, then bent and unlaced the thongs of his skis. Gurlick looked at Saren and Cadrin.
So you finally got something besides a deer. A real snow leopard. Congratulations, Saren.
Saren pulled her scarf away from her mouth and smiled politely.
Thank you, but it isn't mine. I got the deer. Neelan put three arrows through the cat. All of them in the chest. Not much more than a span apart.
In the chest?
Saren rotated the carcass on the fur limb tripod and pointed.
Here, here, and here.
Gerlich inclined his head to Neelan.
My congratulations to you then, Engineer. Your bows must carry further in the winter.
I wish I'd been able to use them at that range.
Neelan pointed to the slash in the jacket.
Then this wouldn't have happened. He got a little closer than I would have ideally preferred. It's hard to fire arrows with claws in your face.
I can see that.
With a look back at Neelan, he crossed the causeway and entered the tower.
Sayre, we really don't need you. You might think about cleaning and dressing that slash. Relan and I will start tanning the pelt. Don't you worry.
Neelan heaved himself erect and picked up the skis and poles.
Thank you. You're probably right.
He stopped at the main level and staggered into the great room, where he slumped at the empty table, too tired to climb the steps. While he really needed to wash out the cut on his shoulder, that meant climbing four more flights of steps and digging out the antiseptic, what little there was left, and then going to the bathhouse. Cadran struggled inside with a deer haunch, followed by Kaisine. Neither looked toward the dimness of the great room.
Should have heard the engineer. Got a little closer than I would have ideally preferred. I thought I'd die! Gerlich was gonna shit building stones.
Engineer's a tough little bastard.
Quiet a lot of the time. Have to be tough to deal with the Marshal. Leopard's probably easy by comparison.
Reba, tougher than a snow leopard? No question about that. But I'd prefer to fight neither.
As the two cooks vanished, he stood and walked toward the steps, and the antiseptic, the cleaning he wasn't looking forward to, and soreness in muscles he'd forgotten he had, and the headache. The headache that seemed not quite constant. Outside the frosted window, the day is dull gray. Even the snow on the fields in the distance is gray. That on the roads below Hissel's room has been tramped into a frozen mixture of brown and gray. The warmth from the small brazier in the corner is more than welcome. Hissel shifts his weight on the stool to warm his right side without taking his eyes from the glass on the table. Centered in the swirling white mists are the images of the black mage and the woman warrior. Each drags a carcass, but the mage drags that of a snowcat up the slope toward the line of smoke that rises from the tower chimneys. Two other figures, also on the long, wide skis, sweep down the slope toward the pair. The mage appears awkward on the skis, but he is the one who drags the snowcat. Their breath puffs through the scarves that cover their faces, then falls in the bright light and powdery crystals toward the snow through which they climb. Hissel's eyes focus on the bows both carry, then narrow.
No thunder throwers now.
Neither of the two skiers who stop on the white expanse above the toiling pair wear thunder throwers either, and Hissel's tight smile broadens. He tries not to think about a mage who will stand fast before a snow leopard, and his eyes flick to the window. The grasslands beyond Clanaya are still covered with white, but the days are again lengthening, and even on the roof of the world, the snows will vanish in time.
I don't understand why Lord Silic is receiving this traitor with such honor.
As she catches the murmur from halfway down the long table on the low dais, Zeljin smiles and under the table squeezes Silic's hand. He turns and smiles at his consort. The young armsman in training stands at the doorway to the dining hall.
The Honorable Lygon of Blayens.
Retaining the smile on his face, Silic stands to greet Lygon. Zeljin rises almost simultaneously. At the end of the table to Silic's right, the Lady Alingia smooths her face into a mold of polite interest. At the end to the left, Sir Gethin cultivates a look of indifference. Lygon, a round-faced man wearing a maroon velvet tunic and a silver chain, marches up between the two rows of tables in the dining hall as the murmurs die away and the leading tradespeople and landowners of Lorinth watch. Lygon steps onto the dais. Silic gestures to the empty seat to his right.
Welcome, Lygon. Welcome to Lornth, and to our hospitality.
He steps back.
This is Zeljin, my lady and consort. Zeljin, this is Lygon, the most honorable traitor of Suthaya.
Whenever you rulers call me honorable, Silic, I want to reach for my purse.
Ligon overtops Silic by half a head, but bows low, first to the Lord of Lorenth, and then to Zeljin.
It's a pleasure to meet you, lady, and to know that Lord Silic has you to enchant him and grace his towers.
It is my pleasure to meet you, sir, and I will do my best to offer such grace, especially since you do us such honor.
We don't want your purse, Ligon, just your presence.
He stands until the traitor sits. Ligon stares frankly at Zeljin for a moment before his eyes return to Silic.
Your consort, she is a true beauty.
His eyes go back to Zeljin.
And you are, my lady. Few indeed have your grace and beauty.
I do my poor best for my lord, for he is dear to me.
Ligon nods, neither agreeing nor disagreeing, as Silic himself pours the red wine from the pitcher between them into two goblets, almost equidistant from each man. The traitor takes the goblet fractionally closer to Silic. Silic lifts the one remaining and raises it.
To your continued health and to good trading.
To health and good trading.
Those at the head table drink with Silic and Ligon, though Zeljin's lips barely pass the wine. Ligon sets his goblet before him and studies the great hall below the dais.
Quite a gathering.
Only the due of a first trader of Suthaya. Even my consort's father made a special trip from Karpa to honor you.
Ligon shakes his head.
First trader, 20th trader. What difference does it make? We're all traders, and we try to be fair to all.
Ligon's voice carries, but his eyes are on Silic, and he does not see how Ser Gethin's lips tighten at his words.
Fairness. That's important to Lorenth. It always will be.
I had hoped that Lorenth would continue the warm relationship enjoyed in the past with the traders of Sathaya, and I'm pleased to see such hospitality again offered.
Ligon downs the remaining wine in his goblet with a single swallow, then slices the pear apple on his plate into slivers and pops a pear apple section and a chunk of roan cheese into his mouth.
Always have good cheeses here.
I'm glad you find them so, and trust you will always do so.
Silic takes a swallow of his wine, a swallow far smaller than it appears.
The wine's better than what your sire served. Where'd you find it?
Silic inclines his head towards Zeljin.
The uplands of Zeljin's father's lands produce a good grape and better wine.
Ha! Consorted well for beauty and good wine. You demon, you.
Silic smiles, as does Zeljin, but at their respective ends of the table, neither Gethin's nor Alindia's face mirrors such apparent pleasure.
Heard some rumors, you know how things go, some rumors that a bunch of crazy women took over a mountaintop on your eastern marches. Some even say they're evil angels.
That has been said, and if they survive the winter, I may well be occupied. Then again... I may be occupied with the Gerani. I'm certain you've also heard that rumor. Well, it's true. I've got my chief armsman in Clania. He's not exactly pleased.
It has also been said that you handed Ildurum a stinging defeat.
Ligon chews through the rest of the pear apple slices, barely avoiding spitting fragments across the linens. At her end of the table, Lady Alindia contains a wince.
The problem with such victories is that they require maintenance. And supplies.
He looks at the traitor.
Oh, no business tonight, Lord Silic. It's a cold winter out there, and tonight's the time for warmth and good food.
I stand corrected.
Silic raises his hands, half in laughter, half in mock defeat. Zeljin smiles. So does her father. Carrying a clean outfit, Neelan padded down the stairs in his boots and old trousers, trying to ignore the chill that seeped around him. He slowed as he neared the fourth level. Gerlich unloaded his gear, racking the quiver in the shelf space that was his, and hung the long bow beside it, his fingers running over the wood, almost lovingly. Then he removed the shoulder harness and the great blade. After extracting a pair of rags from the leather bag, he used one rag first to dry the blade, and afterward the scabbard. Then he unstoppered the flagon and poured a small amount of oil onto the other rag before closing the flagon. Gently, the hunter oiled the blade from hilt to tip. As he watched the hunter, Neelan puzzled over several items. Although Gerlich brought back no game, he had brought back fewer arrows, and shafts and arrowheads were not easy to come by. Had Gerlich lost the shafts?
Perhaps the great hunter is not so great after all.
He shook his head as he studied Gerlich. Why did the hunter carry the huge blade on a hunting trip? Any sort of sword was difficult to use on skis. In fact, anything was hard to use trying to balance on wooden slats spanning deep powder snow. Based on his encounter with the leopard, Neelan could certainly testify to that. He lifted his right shoulder, felt the soreness. Despite the antiseptic, one section of the slash had become inflamed, enough so that Arlen had been forced to use her healing talents, a way of forcing out the disorder of infection. After having watched her do it, Neelan had practiced on the shoulder wound himself, keeping it chaos-free. That talent might come in useful at some point, especially when the few remnants of the medical supplies were exhausted. The talent didn't seem to speed healing much, but it stopped infection and would reduce scarring, he suspected. Gerlich seemed unaware of Neelan on the steps.
Any luck?
Boredom replaced surprise on Gerlich's face.
Not this time. We've killed most of the dumb animals, and I've got to travel further every time.
Sorry to hear that.
Neelan nodded and continued down the steps. There were people near the hearth in the great room, but the engineer continued onward toward the north door. He hurried through the ice-lined archway and into the bathhouse. The stove was yet warm, and the bathhouse was empty, except for him. Neelan stripped off the boots and trousers and checked the knife valve. Then he stood under the frigid water only long enough to get thoroughly wet, before lathering himself with the liquid concoction that Arlen had claimed was the local equivalent of soap. The amber liquid looked like oil laced with sand and flower petals. That was also what it smelled like, rancid flower petals. It felt like liquid sandpaper as Neelan stood, damp and freezing, on the cold stones of a shower stall without a door, trying to scrub grease off his hands, frozen and thawed sweat out of his stiff hair, and grime off most of his body. It took 3 short rinses, just because he couldn't stand under the cold water that long, even though the water had been warmed some by the bathhouse stove's water warmer. The only excuse for a towel was a napless synthetic oblong that might have qualified as a hand towel on Heaven, except for the fact that it was designed to shed water, not absorb it. So Neelan had to use it more to wipe the water off his body, letting a combination of evaporation and what felt like sublimation do the rest. While he looked and smelled more human at the end of the process, the bluish tinge to his skin spoiled the feeling. The goosebumps and shivers remained long after he donned the relatively clean clothes that had taken 2 days to dry after he had washed them. Finally, his feet were dry enough for him to pull on the wool-lined boots. When he had stopped shivering violently, he marched resolutely toward the brick archway that had become a solid arc of ice. After he had carted his old trousers up to the top level, Neelan returned to the great hall and the coals in the hearth. In the dimness, Relin sat on one side, Mercasa on the other, each one's back to the coals. Neither looked at the other. Both shivered.
A cheerful group?
Feeding fowls. That is all I can do that is useful.
Relin raised his artificial hand.
Or sheep. It is so cold that I can barely hold the bag. Your hair is wet.
I couldn't stand being dirty and unshaven any longer. I took a shower.
You have ice in your veins. You are more terrible than the women. They are merely angels trying to live as people.
That's nonsense. I'm trying just as hard.
He stepped toward the residual warmth of the hearth.
They did not think of the tower and build it. They did not find the water that flows when all is frozen. They did not forge the blades of black lightning. They did not build the small bows that send arrows through plate mail.
Relin stood, but his eyes were on the stones of the floor.
They only fought and grew crops and hunted. You forged West Wind and all that it will be. I have finally seen the truth. You are the first true black mage.
Me? I'm the man who can barely cross the snows on skis. The one who couldn't get a thunder thrower to kill anyone.
The thunder throwers do not belong in Kandar, nor do the magical tools you first used. Yet all the weapons you created and all the buildings you built will remain. Everything you forged belongs here on the roof of the world, and everything will last for generations. If you died today, what you have wrought would remain.
That was the general idea. You seem to be the first one to fully understand that.
Neelan paused, and in the silence could hear the sounds of voices and tools and cooking coming up from the lowest level of the tower.
What's so strange about it? I helped to build a tower, but there are towers all over Kandar. I forged some blades, but armsmen all over Kandar carry blades. I created bows, but archers have existed for years.
Relin just shook his head.
Mirkasa?
Neelan turned to the thin and round-faced girl.
Yes, Sir Mage?
Tell the Honorable Relin that he's full of sheep manure.
No, Sir. You are the Black One, and the Marshal is the Angel, and you have brought the legend to the world.
She looked sideways at Relin.
The men of these lands, mayhap of all lands, are like Jilkar. They respect only the strong. You have made these women strong.
They were already strong.
Then you have kept them strong, and they will force the men of Kandar to respect them, and to respect all women.
That is why Silic will come to attack Westwind. After him may come Lord Cathanos of Gallos.
Is that why Lorenth dislikes Gerrans? Strong women?
Relin nodded. The engineer turned toward the windows.
Some mage I am. I can't even keep this place warm enough.
It is warm enough for the angels to grow and prosper. It is warm enough that all Kandar will tremble at the name of Westwind. I should think that would be warm enough.
You give me far too much praise, Relin.
No, Ser. You do not choose to see that you have changed the world. You have changed me, and you will change others. And in time, few indeed will understand the world before the legend.
You are different. You see women as strong, and as you see them, so are they.
Women are strong, stronger than men in many ways.
As you say, Mage.
Neelan shook his head. Why did they take his words as a statement of faith, as if what he said became true? Both Relin and Mirkasa exchanged amused smiles, as if Neelan could not see the obvious. Maybe he couldn't.
I'm going down to work.
Yes, Mage.
They smiled again. A low fire, for once, burned in the heart of the great room. Reba sat in the chair at the end of the table, with Saren on her right and Neelan on the left. Arlen sat beside.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.